Thank you. Or airplane mode, if you like. Sorry?
Not allowed.
Request everyone to please be seated. Everyone standing this side, request you to please take your seats if you could. Yeah, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our chief guest for the evening, the Honorable Union Minister of Home Affairs, Sri Rajnath Singh Ji. The Honorable Union Minister of Home Affairs, Sri Rajnath Singh, Mr. Vivek Goenka, Chairman and Managing Director of the Indian Express Group, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening. On behalf of the Ramnath Goenka Memorial Foundation, we welcome you to the 11th Ramnath Goenka Excellence in Journalism Award Ceremony. An annual event that began as part of the centenary celebrations of Ramnath Goenka to acknowledge and reward the best in journalism nationwide is today being recognized as one of the most coveted awards a journalist can get. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an absolute honor for us to have the Honorable Union Minister of Home Affairs, Sri Rajnath Singh, to present the awards. Thank you very much, sir, for being with us this evening. We are delighted to share with you that the live streaming of the award ceremony, followed by a panel discussion, will be exclusively shown on indianexpress.com, financialexpress.com, jansatta.com, and loksatta.com. You can also follow us on social media with hashtag RNGAwards. The late Ramnath Goenka, founder of the Express Group, was a multifaceted person. He was a freedom fighter, a politician, an industrialist, and a newspaper magnate. But more than anything else, he was an indomitable warrior for the freedom of the press, who carried his mission with unflagging zeal. The Indian Express Group continues with his legacy of setting the benchmark for daily journalism's ability to inform and interpret, challenge and provoke. It is my privilege to share with you all a short film on the founder of the Express Group, Sri Ramnath Goenka.
On Akshaya Tritiya of 1904, a boy was born in the Darbhanga village of Bihar, who would go on to change the face of politics and press in India. Ramnath Goenka moved to Calcutta as a teenager and was put under the tutelage of his maternal uncle, Mahadev Lalji Dalmia. At 22, he moved to Madras to start trading in jute, but was known to be one of the many businessmen supporting the freedom movement in Chennai. Ramnath Ji grew inspired and moved by Gandhi's messages of non-violence. In 1932, in an answer to Gandhi's call for a pro-freedom English newspaper, the Indian Express was launched, which courageously gave voice to the millions of freedom fighters across the country. During the Quit India movement, when Gandhiji was arrested and the press given gagging orders, Ramnath Ji decided to suspend the publication of the Express, demanding Gandhi's release. He said,
"If we went on publishing, the Indian Express may be called a paper, but cannot be called a newspaper. We have therefore decided that this would be our last issue."
Recognized as a courageous freedom fighter, Ramnath Ji was one of the privileged members of the Constituent Assembly and tasked with drafting India's constitution. After independence, the Indian Express took to the role of nation building. Ramnath Ji engaged some of the world's most recognized editors to bring global standards in journalism to India. Here he's seen with Devdas Gandhi of Hindustan Times in London leading a delegation to form the Swadeshi News Agency, Press Trust of India. In the early 70s, when the country's most popular Prime Minister, Indira Gandhi, split the Congress in Congress I and Congress O, he told her,
"You're making a big mistake, Indu."
She asked him,
"Are you a friend or a foe?"
He replied quickly,
"The choice is yours."
In 1975, Mrs. Gandhi declared emergency.
"Hame अपनी आजादी कायम रखनी है।
जयप्रकाश नारायण led the first revolution to fight the emergency with Ramnath ji's full support. Through the emergency, the government's approach to the press was to tame or take over. Possibly the most drastic step taken by the government was to send this notice to the Directorate of Advertising and Publicity to stop advertising in all Express Group publications. Unlike today, in the late 70s, the government was the largest advertiser in the country. This letter shows several fraudulent cases of income tax violations issued by the CBI against the Express. And here, the emotional letter Ramnath ji wrote to K.K. Birla after the government forced him to resign from the board of his own company and appointed K.K. Birla as the chairman of the board. He wrote,
"Parting with the Express is like parting with my son. You said that if I don't fall in line with this proposal, all the members of my family would be held in detention under MISA."
During the emergency, all edits were vetted and cleared by the government. One day, when his edit was not cleared according to his liking, Ramnath ji published a blank editorial. This blank edit page became a symbol of protest against press censorship around the world. But Ramnath Goenka could never be removed from the Express. He got back in control as soon as the emergency was removed. Here, at another attempt to control the free press, he took to the streets with placards. To encourage excellence in journalism, he instituted an award. And here is Swami Chinmayanand giving away the award to R.K. Lakshman. What will inspire journalists in India and around the world, however, will be his role as publisher of the country's most independent news organization, the Indian Express.
It is an honor for me to present you with the most distinguished names which comprise the prize board. Thank you, members of the jury, for the selection that we celebrate this evening.
Dr. S.Y. Qureshi, former Chief Election Commissioner, Election Commission of India. Justice B.N. Sri Krishna, jurist and former judge, Supreme Court of India. Pamela Philippos, journalist and senior fellow, Indian Council of Social Science Research.
Together with our presenting partner, TVS, associate partners NABARD, Bharat Petroleum, Uttar Pradesh Government, JAL, Pitambari, Government of Assam, NDMC, PC Jeweller, Sonalika, REC, Gateway Rail, Flywell Aviation, NTPC, HPM, MP Government, and SRTMI, event partner LIC of India, NGO partner Save the Children, banking partner Union Bank of India, and writing instruments partner Parker, the Ramnath Goenka Memorial Foundation today is proud to once again celebrate excellence in journalism. May I now please request Mr. Vivek Goenka to present the welcome address.
Honorable Union Home Minister Shri Rajnath Singh Ji, our chief guest and keynote speaker this evening, 29 winners of the Ramnath Goenka Awards for Excellence in Journalism for work done in 2017, for the finest in print, broadcast, and purely digital, and all the shortlisted nominees, members of the jury, members of the panel, talented editors who will share with us their insight later this evening on a subject vital to the future of our profession, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. A very happy and a healthy pollution-free New Year to you all in Delhi. I welcome you to this very special evening. It's my privilege to introduce Sri Rajnath Singh Ji. His career in politics not only tells us a remarkable story of personal achievement, but is also a chronicle of his formidable contribution to our public life. A physics teacher, he was schooled in politics during the emergency. He was the JP movement's district coordinator in Uttar Pradesh and became an MLA in the state of in the state assembly for the first time in 1977. Rajnath Ji, therefore, belongs to that spirited generation which fought emergency firsthand. He challenged with his moral conviction the erosion of our fundamental rights, and he worked hard to ensure that we got our democracy back, which makes him, for all of us at the Indian Express, a kindred spirit. In 1992, when our economy was opening up to the world, Rajnath Ji was trying to level a different kind of a playing field. His anti-copying law ushered in sweeping reforms in the state education system. As Surface Transport Minister in the Atal Bihari Vajpayee government, he saw the Golden Quadrilateral take shape, and shortly after that, brought in farm insurance as Agriculture Minister. Two initiatives that, till this day, couldn't be more relevant to the changing India story. Long before competitive federalism became a talisman for our national politics, he knew as the Union Minister that cooperation with the states was essential to the success of central programs. And so his politics was always about cutting across political lines and reaching across the aisle. Politics we now need more than ever, when fault lines, especially in the run-up to the elections, are being drawn so deep and so hard. Rajnath Ji knows how to step beyond these lines. My favorite example of this is from that July afternoon in 2017, when Jammu and Kashmir was in ferment, when the Amarnath Yatra had been attacked by militants, when 8 pilgrims were killed, and the rhetoric on either side was so shrill that nothing could be heard. He stepped in, and yes, with one tweet, he lowered the temperature. He underlined what was obvious. By stating the obvious, as we know, can sometimes be a challenge. He said that the people of Kashmir had strongly condemned the terror attack on Amarnath pilgrims, and this showed that the spirit of Kashmiriyat was very much alive. What his intervention showed was his ability to listen to the voice of anger but not be provoked. This is, after all, a key attribute of good journalism in these times. And that marks the winners of the Ramnath Goenka Excellence in Journalism Awards this evening. In its 13th year, the RNG Awards, as we choose to call them, I'm happy to report the 650 nominations saw a record number of shortlisted in the print and broadcast. I keep this count every year, and this time I'm pleased to report that only 6 of the 29 winners this evening are those who have won RNGs earlier. Of the repeat winners, print has 2. Broadcast has 4. So clearly, this is eloquent evidence of the fact that good journalists are not in short supply. We need to remind ourselves of this empowering fact, especially at a time when good journalism faces challenges from a range of sources because of both the medium and the message. Good journalism is its own reward. It strengthens our profession, and a good story, well told, fairly and accurately, is the most powerful counter to those who try to shut us up. The winning stories this evening exemplify this. from investigating illegal beach sand mining in Tamil Nadu to exploring what does farm distress mean to the daily life of a farmer and his or her family, calling out day after day a state government's attempt to silence criticism, to tracking the dreams of women cricketers in a Punjab village, or blowing the cover of a secret operation inside the tobacco giant's campaign to subvert public health, and a seminal book on the nexus between crime and politics in our country and its implications on the quality of our democracy. This is a remarkable range of work that goes way beyond merely witness, that takes the headlines and goes in search of what lies behind them. It keeps asking questions, never gives up until it has found answers, and in many, many cases, finds more questions. It's not that we have read or watched these stories for the first time. Each one has already been published or broadcast, and each one is just one Google search away. This means that there is excellent journalism out there if we look beyond the 9 p.m. shouting brigade on television or beyond the WhatsApp forwards. This excellence needs constant reiteration and renewal. So please join me in doing that by welcoming the Honorable Home Minister Shri Rajnath Singh Ji to present the RNG Awards for 2017. And after he does that, share with us his thoughts on what we in the media need to resolve and reflect upon as we start a very newsy new year. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Goenka. Over the years, Ramnath Goenka Excellence in Journalism Awards has recognized some of the finest names in Indian journalism. These awards have set a much-needed benchmark for journalism in the country and are open to journalists from print, digital, and broadcast media. But only those who have shown extraordinary strength of character and integrity while reporting news accurately under dangerous or difficult circumstances are shortlisted and honored. Ladies and gentlemen, we now proceed to the much-awaited awards presentation for felicitating the winners of the year 2017 by the Honorable Union Minister of Home Affairs, Shri Rajnath Singh Ji. Live streaming of the award ceremony will be exclusively shown on indianexpress.com, financialexpress.com, jansatta.com, and loksatta.com. You can also follow us on social media with hashtag RNGAwards. We begin the ceremony with the first category, which is given in memory of the former resident editor of the Indian Express, Pune, Prakash Kardale, a very proactive journalist who was also one of the prime movers behind the Right to Information Act. In the category, Prakash Kardale Memorial Award for Civic Journalism.
The winner is Shalini Nair from the Indian Express.
Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. The second award is in the category Uncovering India Invisible. The category is brought to you by NABARD.
For print, the winner is Parth Meena Nikhil from ruralindiaonline.com. And for broadcast, the winner is Pratima Mishra from ABP News.
Thank you. Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. The next set of awards is in the category Hindi.
For print, the winner is Amit Kumar Singh from thewire.in. And for broadcast, the winner is Abhisar Sharma from ABP News.
Congratulations, thank you very much. Please be seated. The next award is for the category of books, non-fiction.
The winner is Milan Vaishnav for the book When Crime Pays, Money and Muscle in Indian Politics.
Friends, Milan is overseas at the moment, so we have Udayan Mitra from HarperCollins, Publishers India, to collect the award on his behalf. The next category is regional languages.
For print, the winners are Sandeep Ashok Acharya and Nishant Dattaram Sarvankar from Lok Sabha. And for broadcast, the winner is M. Gunusekaran from News 18, Tamil Nadu.
Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. We now move on to the next category that accolades the best in the field of sports journalism. In the category of sports journalism,
for print, the winners are Nitin Sharma and Daksh Panwar from the Indian Express. And for broadcast, the winner is Mohammed Hassan from India Today TV.
Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. The next category of awards is for reporting from Jammu and Kashmir and the Northeast.
For print, the winners are Namrata B.G. Ahuja from The Week and Rikinti Marvin from Highland Post. And for broadcast, the winner is Safar Iqbal from NDTV India.
Congratulations. Thank you very much. Please be seated. The next set of awards is in the category of environmental reporting.
For print, the winner is Sandhya Ravishankar from thewire.in. And for broadcast, the winner is Sushil Chandra Bahugana from NDTV India.
Congratulations and thank you very much. The next set of awards is for business and economic journalism, and the category is brought to you by Sonalika.
For print, the winner is Team Reuters from Thomson Reuters. And for broadcast, the winner is Sushil Kumar Mohapatra from NDTV India.
Thank you and congratulations. Please be seated. In the category of foreign correspondent covering India,
the winner is Annie Gowan from the Washington Post.
Regret that the winner is unable to be here, but congratulations to her nevertheless. For the category of investigative reporting,
for print, the winner is Vijay Kumar S. from The Hindu. And for broadcast, the winner is Anand Kumar Patel from India Today TV.
Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. For the category of on-the-spot reporting,
for print, the winner is Ridula Chari from scroll.in. And for broadcast, the winner is Jagwinder Patial from ABP News.
Congratulations to you and thank you very much. Please be seated. The next award is for the category of commentary and interpretative writing.
The winner is Gulab Kothari from Rajasthan Patrika.
Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. The next award is for the category of feature writing.
The winner is Dipankar Ghosh from The Indian Express.
Congratulations, please be seated. The next set of awards is in the category of reporting on politics and government.
For print, the winner is Sushant Kumar Singh from The Indian Express. And for broadcast, The winner is Rajesh Rajput from ABP News.
Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. The next set of awards is in the category of photojournalism.
The winner is Ashi Tobya from the Indian Express.
Congratulations to you. Thank you very much. Please be seated. And now it is time to present the internal awards for the young team members of the Indian Express group. Of the Indian Express, Sanjeev Sinha Memorial Award for Excellence in Reporting.
The winner is Aanchal Magazine.
Congratulations and thank you. And now for the Priya Chandrasekhar Memorial Award for Excellence in Editing.
The winner is Ram Sarangan.
Congratulations and thank you very much. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, please put your hands together for all the awardees of the Ramnath Goenka Excellence in Journalism Awards 2017. Thank you, Honorable Chief Guest Rajnath Singhji, the Honorable Union Minister for Home Affairs, for presenting the awards. It is an absolute honor and privilege to have you join us this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, we are delighted to share that the keynote of the Honorable Chief Guest will be live streamed exclusively, shown on indianexpress.com, financialexpress.com, jansatta.com, and loksatta.com. May I please request our Honorable Chief Guest, Rajnath Singhji, the Honorable Union Minister for Home Affairs, to share the keynote address with the audience.
श्री विवेक गोयनका जी और हमारे डिफरेंट पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज के सारे सीनियर लीडर्स और मेरे जर्नलिस्ट मित्रों, मैं अपने सामने कुछ लीडर्स को देखकर बहुत असमंजस की स्थिति में हूँ। यदि मैं स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका के बारे में बोलूँगा इमरजेंसी के दौरान अथवा उसके बाद भी जो उनकी भूमिका रही है, तो मुझे सचमुच कुछ संकोच की अनुभूति हो रही है, क्योंकि हमारे कुछ कांग्रेस के मित्र भी यहाँ पर बैठे हुए हैं। आप ये कहेंगे कि खुलकर बोलना चाहिए, लेकिन आप जानते हैं कि आंखों की लिहाज भी होती है और लोकतंत्र लोकलाज से ही चलता है। लेकिन मैं जानता हूं कि सारे हमारे मित्र हैं, जो कुछ भी मैं कहूंगा उसका कम से कम इस समय अन्यथा नहीं लेंगे। सबसे पहले तो इस कार्यक्रम में आकर मैं कहना चाहूँगा कि मुझे बेहद खुशी हुई है। आप ये जानना चाहेंगे कि मुझे क्यों बेहद खुशी हुई है। सामान्यतः मैं कार्यक्रमों में बहुत जल्दी जाने की अपनी सहमति नहीं देता हूं, लेकिन ज्यों ही मुझसे कहा गया कि आप एक कार्यक्रम हो रहा है, उस कार्यक्रम में आपको की नोट एड्रेस के लिए चलना है, सहज रूप से मैंने अपनी सहमति दे दी। उसका केवल एक कारण था, स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका के प्रति हमारे दिल में गहरी आस्था जब मैं युवा था 24 साल का तब से रही है। इमरजेंसी का दौर था, मैं भी सेंट्रल जेल नैनी में था, उसके पहले 2-2.5 महीने तक बिल्कुल तन्हाई, सॉलिटरी जेल वो बोलते हैं, तन्हाई, उसमें मैं था। और सेंट्रल जेल नैनी में सारे हमारे इलाहाबाद यूनिवर्सिटी के टीचर्स और बहुत अन्य दूसरी पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज के लीडर्स भी थे। शायद ही ऐसा कोई दिन गुजरा होगा जिस दिन की स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका की चर्चा सेंट्रल जेल नैनी में न हुई हो। मैं उनसे प्रत्यक्ष कभी मिला नहीं हूं, लेकिन जो कुछ भी उनके बारे में मैंने सुना उसी के कारण उनके प्रति मन के अंदर जो एक भाव पैदा हुआ, इस कारण मैंने अपनी सहज रूप से सहमत दे दी और सचमुच मुझे इस कार्यक्रम में आकर बेहद खुशी हुई है। मैं उन सभी पत्रकारों को और मीडिया कर्मियों को भी बधाई देना चाहता हूं जिन्हें उनके काम के लिए आज यह अवार्ड हासिल हुआ है। स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका, मैं मानता हूं कि पत्रकारिता जगत में अपने एक्सलेंस के लिए ही वह जाने माने जाते हैं, और अच्छा किया मैनेजमेंट ने, हमारे विवेक गोयनका जी ने, कि जो अवार्ड भी स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका के नाम पर रखा, वह एक्सलेंस इन जर्नलिज्म अवार्ड, यह उसका नाम रखा है। आप सभी जानते हैं कि किसी व्यक्ति अथवा किसी भी संस्था की यदि पहचान होती है तो उसकी पहचान इस बात पर निर्भर करती है, जब कभी संकट की स्थिति सामने पैदा हो, कोई बड़ी चुनौती सामने आकर खड़ी हो, तो वह किस तरीके से उसका मुकाबला करता है, किस तरीके से उस पर विजय प्राप्त करता है, इसका मूल्यांकन करने के बाद ही हम कह सकते हैं कि उस व्यक्ति की यह आइडेंटिटी है, उस व्यक्ति की यह पहचान है। यदि मैं यह कहूं कि स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका ने इमरजेंसी के दौरान तूफान के खिलाफ चिराग जलाने का काम किया, दिया जलाने का काम किया, तो यह कहना भी अतिशयोक्तिपूर्ण नहीं होगी। और मैं कह सकता हूं कि स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका ने जो वह दिया जलाया, वह इमरजेंसी का तूफान होने के बावजूद भी वह दिया बुझने नहीं पाया, सबसे बड़ी विशेषता स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका की यह रही। और मेरी निश्चित धारणा है कि सिर्फ पत्रकारिता जगत ही, जो कुछ भी इमरजेंसी के दौरान उन्होंने किया अथवा बाद में भी पत्रकारिता क्षेत्र में जो उनका योगदान रहा है, उसके लिए केवल पत्रकारिता जगत ही उनका ऋणी नहीं रहेगा, बल्कि मैं मानता हूं कि इस भारत की लोकतांत्रिक व्यवस्था भी स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका की ऋणी रहेगी। यह हमारी धारणा है। इमरजेंसी के दौरान क्या हुआ भारत की राजनीतिक सत्ता के द्वारा, और समय समय पर आगे भी जो भी भ्रष्टाचार के मामले आए हों, उन मामलों को लेकर स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका के नेतृत्व में इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ने जो लाइन खींची है, मैं केवल इंडियन एक्सप्रेस के कार्यक्रम में हूं इसलिए नहीं कह रहा हूं मित्रों, मैं हृदय की गहराइयों से कह रहा हूं कि जो इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ने लाइन खींची है वह अमिट है, उसको कोई मिटा नहीं सकता है। बहुत सारे राजनेता इमरजेंसी में जेल में थे, प्रारंभ में तो यह नहीं लगता था कि हमारे भविष्य क्या होगा, लेकिन बाद के कुछ समय के बाद जनता का मूड जिस तरीके से बदलता हुआ दिखाई दिया, बहुत लोगों को यह उम्मीद थी कि इमरजेंसी जब समाप्त होगी उसके बाद हम सब भी सत्ता में आ सकते हैं, लेकिन मैं समझता हूं कि यह ख्वाब, यह सपना भले ही राजनेताओं का रहा हो, लेकिन रामनाथ जी गोयनका का यह सपना नहीं था, क्योंकि भले ही गोयनका जी के आंदोलन के कारण सत्ता में बदल होती, लेकिन गोयनका जी को सत्ता से कुछ लेना देना नहीं था, फिर भी वो बराबर अपना संघर्ष उन्होंने जारी रखा है। इमरजेंसी का विरोध करने वाले करने से इंडियन एक्सप्रेस की विश्वसनीयता मैं जानता हूं कि इस सीमा तक बढ़ गई थी, इस सीमा तक बढ़ गई थी कि सरकार को एक्सप्रेस की जरूरत तो महसूस होती थी, लेकिन आज भी मैं कह सकता हूं इंडियन एक्सप्रेस को किसी सरकार की जरूरत महसूस नहीं होती है। इस हद तक विश्वसनीयता इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ने और इस ग्रुप ने हासिल की है। मुझे याद है श्री राजीव गांधी जी की सरकार ने जिस समय एंटी डिफेमेशन बिल लाया था, आज भी वह चित्र मेरी आंखों के सामने पूरी तरह से तरोताजा है। उस समय प्रेस फ्रीडम को एक कर्टेल करने की कोशिश की गई तो गोयनका जी चुप्पी साध कर नहीं बैठे, बल्कि उसके खिलाफ भी उन्होंने बिगुल फूंक दिया। और मुझे याद है कि पैदल चलकर संसद तक जाने का काम किसी के नेतृत्व में हुआ था, तो हमारे रामनाथ जी गोयनका के ही नेतृत्व में हुआ था। एक अपना एक विशेष चरित्र है इस इंडियन एक्सप्रेस का, और एक विशेष चरित्र, एक स्पेसिफिक करेक्टर जो इंडियन एक्सप्रेस का बना है, उसमें मेजर कंट्रीब्यूशन या मैं कहूं कि 100% कंट्रीब्यूशन यदि किसी का है तो हमारे रामनाथ जी गोयनका का है। इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ने आज़ादी की लड़ाई के दौर में भी जो कुछ भी किया है उससे भी आप सभी अच्छी तरह परिचित हैं। उसी दौर में गांधी जी की आवाज़ पर ही इंडियन एक्सप्रेस यह स्थापित हुआ था, और गांधी जी चाहते थे कि यह बात सबके सामने आनी चाहिए कि अंग्रेजों के द्वारा देश की जनता पर किस प्रकार का जुल्म ढाया जा रहा है। और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ने गांधी जी की मंशा के अनुरूप ही बढ़ चढ़कर इस न्याय की लड़ाई में एक हिस्सा लिया था, और अंग्रेजों के अत्याचार के खिलाफ जनता को जागरूक करने के लिए उस समय भी जब हमको आज़ादी नहीं हासिल हुई थी उस समय भी इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ने बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण भूमिका का निर्वाह किया था। अब जब कभी इस समय शायद लोगों के द्वारा जो अभिव्यक्त की स्वतंत्रता की बात की जाती है तो मेरी यह बात समझ में नहीं आती कि उस समय भी जिन लोगों के द्वारा भी अभिव्यक्त की स्वतंत्रता की बात की जाती है उस समय क्या उन लोगों के द्वारा अभिव्यक्त की स्वतंत्रता की बात की गई थी। मैं चाहता हूं कि इस सवाल का जवाब किसी को देने की जरूरत नहीं है, खुद ही हम इस सवाल का जवाब हम तलाशने की कोशिश करें। रामनाथ जी गोयनका ने उस दौर में 1932 में इसकी स्थापना की थी इंडियन एक्सप्रेस, और यह बड़े साहस का काम था। यदि मैं यह कहूं कि रामनाथ जी गोयनका के डीएनए में ही यह साहस था तो यह कहना भी एग्जैगरेशन नहीं होगा, और रामनाथ जी गोयनका के ही डीएनए में साहस था यह नहीं कहना चाहता हूं, बल्कि मैं इंडियन एक्सप्रेस के बारे में भी कहना चाहता हूं कि इंडियन एक्सप्रेस के भी डीएनए में वही साहस है। और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस की टैग लाइन यह मैं मानता हूं कि जर्नलिज्म ऑफ करेज है, यह इस अखबार और इस संस्था का, इसके संस्थापक का जिया हुआ और भोगा हुआ सचमुच एक यथार्थ है, यह एक हकीकत है। और यह यथार्थ और यह हकीकत आज भारत के सारे जर्नलिस्ट के लिए मैं मानता हूं कि यह प्रेरक है, इंस्पायर करने वाला है, उनके लिए एक आदर्श है। आज़ादी के पहले भी अखबार राजनीतिक और सामाजिक चेतना के बहुत ही सशक्त और प्रभावी माध्यम हुआ करते थे। आप जानते हैं कि जिस समय आज़ादी की लड़ाई चल रही थी उसमें बहुत सारे नेताओं ने तरह तरह के समाचार पत्र लोकमत तैयार करने के लिए, जनमत तैयार करने के लिए उन्होंने निकाले थे, चाहे महात्मा गांधी का हरिजन और यंग इंडिया रहा हो, चाहे राजा राम मोहन का संवाद कौमुदी रहा हो, तिलक जी का केसरी रहा हो, बिपिन चंद पाल का परिदर्शक रहा हो, और चाहे मौलाना आज़ाद का अलहिलाल रहा हो, और गणेश शंकर विद्यार्थी का प्रताप और मदन मोहन मालवीय का लीडर, ऐसे सारे नेताओं ने जनमत तैयार करने के लिए इस प्रकार के अखबार निकाले थे। और जबकि अंग्रेजों का जुल्म और अत्याचार उस समय एक्सट्रीम पर था, वो चरम पर था, मैं तो यह मानता हूं कि सचमुच अकबर इलाहाबादी ने जो कहा है, खींचो न कमानों को, खींचो न कमानों को, न तलवार निकालो, जब तोप मुकाबिल हो तो अखबार निकालो, ये अकबर इलाहाबादी ने कहा है। और शायद यह सब कुछ देखते हुए भी, जो कुछ भी आजादी की लड़ाई में, जिस तरीके से आजादी की लड़ाई में लड़ी गई है नेताओं के द्वारा, उन सबको देखते हुए उन्होंने जो कहा है, मैं समझता हूं कि यह सच्चाई है। और इसी सच्चाई को सदैव अपने जिंदगी भर उन्होंने इसका पालन किया है। और यह सब मैं इसलिए कह रहा हूं कि यह सच्ची पत्रकारिता ही देश को एक ताकत देने का काम करती है। केवल देश को ही ताकत देने का काम नहीं करती है, बल्कि सचमुच भारत के लोकतंत्र को भी मजबूत करने का काम करती है। इसलिए कभी कभी एक आध दो ऐसी घटनाएं भी देखने को मिलती हैं जब किसी भी खबर को एक मसालेदार बनाने की कोशिश की जाती है, सनसनीखेज एक स्वरूप उसे देने की कोशिश की जाती है। मैं यह मानता हूं कि यदि किसी न्यूज को, किसी खबर को सनसनीखेज बनाने की अथवा उसे मसालेदार बनाने की यदि यह कोशिश की जाती है, मेरी यह धारणा है, हो सकता है किसी की धारणा हो अथवा न हो, लेकिन मेरी यह धारणा है कि यह एक पत्रकारिता का अपमान है। और मैं कह सकता हूं कि स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका ने इस पत्रकारिता का अपने रहते हुए कभी अपमान नहीं होने दिया है। अब यदि जितने भी यहां पर राजनेता बैठे हैं, सबकी जिंदगी में कुछ ना कुछ घटनाएं हुई होंगी, हम लोगों की जिंदगी में भी कुछ घटनाएं हुई हैं। अब जैसे आज के कुछ दिन पहले की ही बात, मैंने देखा कि वेबसाइट से एक न्यूज जो मुझसे भी संबंधित थी उसमें निकली कि 3700 करोड़ रुपए का घोटाला करने वाला भारत के गृह मंत्री राजनाथ सिंह का बहुत ही नजदीकी है, और मुझे एक ज्ञापन देते हुए उसको कहीं पर दिखा दिया। हम लोग जनप्रतिनिधि हैं, हमसे सैकड़ों लोग रोज मिलने के लिए आते हैं, कौन किसने ज्ञापन दिया, क्या है ज्ञापन में, वो तो ज्ञापन हाथ में आने के बाद ही पढ़े, कोई पढ़ सकता है। आज मोबाइल सबके हाथों में है, कहां से किसने वो फोटोग्राफ ले ली, अब उस बारे में तो मैं कह नहीं सकता वो कौन व्यक्ति है, मैं जानता हूं कि नहीं जानता हूं, लेकिन मैं समझता हूं कि अच्छा रहा होता कि उन्होंने इसका वेरिफिकेशन कर लिया होता, मुझसे पूछ लिया होता कि घटना सच है कि घटना गलत है, क्या है। लेकिन कुछ ऐसी भी घटनाएं हो जाया करती, मैं समझता हूं कि इससे हम सबको बचने की कोशिश करनी चाहिए। लेकिन अधिकांश लोग मैं जानता हूं कि कोशिश यही करते हैं कि यदि आलोचना भी होती है तो उसे एक स्पोर्टिंग स्पिरिट में लेना चाहिए, और मैंने भी अपनी जिंदगी में यही कोशिश की है कि चाहे जो भी आलोचना हुई हो उसे स्पोर्टिंग स्पिरिट में ही लेने का मैंने प्रयास किया है। मित्रों, पत्रकारिता को मैं मानता हूं कि निर्भीकता और निरपेक्षता और राष्ट्रीयता के मानस पर ही इसे देखा जाना चाहिए, इसी पैमाने पर ही इसे देखा जाना चाहिए। यदि यह इस पर खरा उतरती है तो पत्रकारिता निश्चित रूप से अपने एक्सलेंस के लिए जानी जाएगी, यह मेरा पक्का विश्वास है। और हमें इस बात का भी ध्यान रखना होगा, जो पत्रकारिता राष्ट्र के खिलाफ हो, किसी प्रकार का डिस्ट्रक्शन, किसी प्रकार का विघटन, करप्शन जैसी ताकतों के लिए वह कवर का काम करती हो, वह इस प्रकार की पत्रकारिता किसी व्यक्ति, किसी दल या संस्था का तो एजेंडा वो हो सकती है, परंतु ऐसी पत्रकारिता कभी पत्रकारिता नहीं हो सकती है, यह मेरी मान्यता है। मैंने देखा है कि कभी कभी ये भी हो जाता है, स्वाभाविक है, यंग एज में बहुतों को देखा है कि अपने प्रतिद्वंदियों से आगे निकलने के लिए उस होड़ में कुछ ऐसी खबरें दे जाते हैं, मैं समझता हूं कि कुछ ऐसी खबरें रहती हैं कि उन खबरों से यदि बचा जाए तो यह ज्यादा अच्छा होगा, यह एक मेरा सुझाव है। और मेरा पत्रकार मित्रों का कोई एक और यह मैं अपनी तरफ से सुझाव देना चाहता हूं कि चाहे कोई व्यक्ति हो, संगठन हो अथवा संस्था, इसके द्वारा कोई भी आपके साथ जोर जबरदस्ती होती है तो ऐसे हर प्रहार का जवाब यदि दिया जाना चाहिए तो अखबार से ही उसका जवाब दिया जाना चाहिए और अखबार के माध्यम से उसका जवाब दिया जा सकता है। और स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका ने अपने जीवन में से सच करके दिखाया है, मैं ऐसा मानता हूं। पत्रकारिता के बारे में सभी ये कहते हैं कि यह लोकतंत्र की पहरेदार है, और हम ये कह सकते हैं कि यह पत्रकारिता सचमुच लोकतंत्र का एक बैरोमीटर भी है। पत्रकार और पत्रकारिता जितनी सबल होगी, मेरा यह मानना है कि लोकतंत्र उतना ही स्वस्थ होगा और लोकतंत्र में उतनी ही चमक आएगी। क्योंकि आप जानते हैं, पहरेदार जितना जागरूक और निडर होगा, लोकतंत्र भी उतना ही चमकदार होगा। इसलिए पत्रकारिता को संविधान का चौथा स्तंभ कहा गया है। विधायिका, कार्यपालिका, नगरपालिका और चौथा स्तंभ है तो खबर पालिका है, चौथा स्तंभ। मित्रों, मैं समझता हूं कि आप मेरी इस बात से भी सहमत होंगे कि पत्रकारिता जनता से एक सामान्य कोई रिश्ता नहीं है, जिसमें बहुत एक लचक हो, ऐसा रिश्ता नहीं है, लचर रिश्ता नहीं है, बल्कि पत्रकारिता एक भरोसे का रिश्ता है। और यह भरोसा सालों साल की कड़ी तपस्या के बाद यह बनता है। एक दो दिन में यह रिश्ता भरोसे का और विश्वास का नहीं बनता है। इसलिए हम सभी को बराबर सजग रहना चाहिए कि लोगों का जो भरोसा है, लोगों का जो विश्वास है, वह किसी भी सूरत में टूटने ना पाए। यदि रामनाथ जी गोयनका आज भी हमारे दिलों में जिंदा हैं, तो इसके लिए भरोसे और विश्वास की जो उनकी तपस्या है, वही कारण है जिस कारण से आज भी स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका हम लोगों के दिलों में जिंदा है। और इस तपस्या की खातिर उन्होंने न तो सत्ता की परवाह की, न सिस्टम की, और न कभी अपने अखबार के वजूद की भी उन्होंने परवाह की, कभी इसकी चिंता नहीं की। और मैं जानता हूं कि हमें बहुत से लोग ऐसे भी होते हैं जो सच के साथ खड़े रहना चाहते हैं, लेकिन कभी कभी उनकी मजबूरी होती है कि सच के साथ वो खड़े नहीं हो पाते। जो सच के साथ खड़े रहना चाहते हैं लेकिन हौसला नहीं कर पाते सच के साथ खड़े रहने का, मैं कहूंगा उनके लिए यदि कोई आदर्श हो सकता है प्रेरणा हासिल करने का, तो वह स्वर्गीय रामनाथ जी गोयनका ही हो सकते हैं। ऐसे लोगों के लिए सचमुच वह मिसाल भी थे, और जब भी बोला सच बोला और एक मकसद के लिए उन्होंने बोला, ऐसी हमारी एक मान्यता है। मैं यह भी जानता हूं कि रामनाथ जी गोयनका ने इमरजेंसी से लड़ने के लिए भारी कीमत चुकाई है, और एक समय तो ऐसे हालात पैदा हो गए कि नानाजी देशमुख, उस समय उनके अभिन्न मित्रों में थे, नानाजी देशमुख से उन्होंने कहा कि मैं एक लोटा और एक जोड़ी धोती लेकर आया था, मैं वापस चला जाऊंगा, लेकिन जीते जी मैं अपने वसूलों से कभी समझौता नहीं करूंगा। यह रामनाथ जी गोयनका ने कहा था। और मुझे यह भी जानकारी है, और उसी समय इस बात की चर्चा होती थी, न्यूज प्रिंट भी खरीदने का शायद पैसा नहीं, शेष नहीं बचा था। लोग यह बतलाते थे कि उनके परिवार की शायद ऐसी हालत हो गई है, चर्चा होती थी इस बात की। यह भी तैयारी घर की माताएं बहनें करने लगी थीं कि अब हमको ज्वेलरी बेच देनी चाहिए, लेकिन यह प्रेस चलनी चाहिए। कैसा वह समय रहा होगा। एक बार तो भीषण दबाव के चलते उन्होंने झुकने के बजाय अखबार को भी बंद करने का फैसला कर लिया था। शायद उस समय यदि वह दबाव में आ गए होते या झुक गए होते और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस का पब्लिकेशन वह करते रहते, तो मैं समझता हूं यह इंडियन एक्सप्रेस, जैसा कि देखा हम लोगों ने प्रेजेंटेशन में, एक पेपर तो कहा जाता लेकिन एक विश्वसनीय न्यूज पेपर कभी न बन पाता। अंग्रेजों से भी लड़ते समय उन्होंने अपना अखबार की परवाह कभी नहीं की, इंडियन एक्सप्रेस को मैं जानता हूँ, उन पहले अखबारों में से एक था जो गांधी जी के भारत छोड़ो आंदोलन के समर्थन में बंद कर दिया गया जब ब्रिटिश सरकार का एक गैग ऑर्डर निकला था, उसमें बंद कर दिया गया था। और एडिटोरियल में जो लिखा है रामनाथ जी ने, मैं उसको कोट करना चाहूँगा, उसको हिंदी में मैंने ट्रांसलेट किया है। मानव जाति अपनी स्वाधीनता के लिए संघर्ष कर रही है, पर इसका क्या मतलब है? जब तक इसमें हमारे देश की स्वतंत्रता न शामिल हो, ये हार्ड फैक्ट है। अगर दबाव में हम इंडियन एक्सप्रेस का पब्लिकेशन करते रहे तो यह एक पेपर कहा जाएगा, पर न्यूज पेपर कभी नहीं हो सकता। इसलिए हमने निश्चय किया है कि फिलहाल हमारा, मैंने यह निश्चय किया है कि ये फिलहाल हमारा अंतिम संस्करण होगा। यह एडिटोरियल लिखते हुए उन्होंने कहा कि शायद इसके बाद हमारा यह अखबार न निकल पाए, न पब्लिश हो पाए, यह बात उन्होंने कही थी। यानी वसूल के किस हद तक वह पक्के थे। और इमरजेंसी के दौरान अगले ही दिन इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ने विरोध स्वरूप ब्लैंक एडिटोरियल भी निकाला इमरजेंसी के खिलाफ। इससे ताकतवर मैं समझता हूं कि और कोई दूसरा संदेश नहीं हो सकता था। रामनाथ जी गोयनका के अखबार का मतलब लोकहित था, न कि अपने हितों की पूर्ति करना अथवा अपने हितों की सुरक्षा के लिए काम करना। मैं समझता हूं कि पत्रकारिता जगत के लिए, सभी के लिए एक इंस्पायर करने वाली एक ऐसी शख्सियत रामनाथ जी गोयनका थे। मित्रों, मैं आपका ध्यान आकर्षित करना चाहता हूं कि आजकल की पत्रकारिता के सामने एक बड़ी चुनौती सोशल मीडिया की भी खड़ी हो रही है। फेक न्यूज, पेड न्यूज, स्पॉन्सर न्यूज, कलर न्यूज की चुनौती है। अब इनसे पत्रकारिता जगत कैसे निपटेगा, मैं समझता हूं यह एक देखने का विषय है। सोशल मीडिया का चाहे जितना विस्तार क्यों न हो जाए, लेकिन यह मैं मानता हूं कन्वेंशनल मीडिया का महत्व तब तक खत्म नहीं होगा जब तक आपके खबरों की और आपके रिपोर्ट्स की क्रेडिबिलिटी बनी रहेगी, तब तक कन्वेंशनल मीडिया का महत्व किसी भी सूरत में कम नहीं हो सकता है। फेक न्यूज का चलना यह कोई अनहोनी बात नहीं है। सोशल मीडिया नहीं थी तब भी जो है फेक न्यूज कभी कभी लिखा करते थे लोग। मैं देख रहा था 30 दिसंबर के हिंदू के अखबार में एक जानकारी मुझे मिली कि फेक न्यूज के कारण डेर स्पीगल, यह न्यूज पेपर है, उसको लिखने वाले मिस्टर क्लैथ रिलोटियस हैं, तो उन्होंने जो घटना घटित नहीं हुई उसके बावजूद वो अपना न्यूज बनाने का काम किया करते थे। उसका परिणाम क्या हुआ, यह बात मीडिया मैनेजमेंट के ध्यान में आई, तो मीडिया मैनेजमेंट ने जब उनसे बातचीत की तो उसके बाद बहुत सारे अवार्ड्स उनको मिले हुए थे, सारे अवार्ड्स उन्होंने वापस कर दिए और साथ ही साथ अपनी मीडिया से निकाल कर उन्हें, फिर मैनेजमेंट ने उन्हें बाहर भी कर दिया था। तो मैं समझता हूँ कि ऐसे हालात हम लोगों की ज़िंदगी में कभी पैदा ना हों, यह सावधानी भी बरतने की आवश्यकता है। मैंने देखा है कि पत्रकारिता में कितनी बड़ी ताकत होती है। कभी कभी समाचार पत्रों में यदि कोई खबर रहती है ऐसी जिसका कि एक आम जनता के लिए अथवा पब्लिक इंटरेस्ट में जिसकी एक विशेष अहमियत होती है, कभी कभी सुप्रीम कोर्ट और हाई कोर्ट भी उसका कॉग्निजेंस लेते हैं और उस आधार पर अपने फैसले भी दिया करते हैं। इतना महत्व होता है आप जो लिखते हैं, जो आपकी कलम चलती है। और मैं समझता हूँ कभी गलती, इंसान है तो गलती हो सकती है, लेकिन यदि गलती हो गई तो अपनी गलती को स्वीकार कर लेने में कभी संकोच नहीं होना चाहिए। और गलती स्वीकार करना मैं समझता हूँ कि बहुत हिम्मत का काम होता है, एक बहुत करेज का काम होता है। और गलती स्वीकार करने का काम कभी छोटे मन का व्यक्ति नहीं कर सकता, गलती स्वीकार करने का काम बराबर बड़े मन का ही व्यक्ति कर सकता है, ये हमारी धारणा है। और मेरा यह भी मानना है कि मीडिया के संचालनकर्ताओं को सरकार, सिस्टम और जनता के बीच भी एक संवाद सेतु की भूमिका निभानी चाहिए। और मैं कह सकता हूँ इंडियन एक्सप्रेस और बहुत सारे भी ऐसे भी समाचार पत्र हैं कि निश्चित रूप से इस जिम्मेदारी का वो बखूबी निर्वाह कर रहे हैं। मैं यह भी मानता हूं कि यह मानसिकता भी ठीक नहीं है कि सरकार और मीडिया में दोस्ती नहीं हो सकती, किसी से भी गलतियां हो सकती हैं। लेकिन मेरा यह मानना है कि यह दो जो पिलर्स हैं, इसमें दोस्ती न हो लेकिन कम से कम बैर भाव नहीं होना चाहिए। यह सावधानी जो भी हमारे जर्नलिस्ट हैं उनको ध्यान रखनी चाहिए, और मैं जानता हूं कि इसका ध्यान बराबर रखा जाता है, और कई समाचार पत्रों के बारे में मैं कह सकता हूं कि इस बात का वह विशेष ध्यान रखते हैं। यह भी मैं जानता हूं कि हमारे अधिकांश मीडिया संस्थान राष्ट्रीय हितों के लिए पूरी तरह से प्रतिबद्ध हैं और अपनी जिम्मेदारी वह अच्छी तरह समझते हैं, परंतु कभी कभी उन तत्वों को भी सह मिल जाती है जो देश के संविधान और तंत्र को समाप्त करने के अभियान में लगे हुए हैं। और यह बात मित्रों मैं इसलिए कह रहा हूँ, जब कभी किसी के द्वारा लिख दिया जाता है, आज मैं भारत का एक गृहमंत्री के रूप में जिम्मेदारी का निर्वाह कर रहा हूँ, नक्सल सर गांधीयन विद गन, अब यह जब न्यूज आती है तो क्षमा कीजिएगा, किसी को यह बात हमारी गलत भी लग सकती है, लेकिन जब इस प्रकार की चीज़ें मैं देखता हूँ नक्सल्स आर गांधीयन विद गन, तो मैं तो इसकी कल्पना भी नहीं कर सकता, गांधी के साथ गन, ये कहां से आ गया? और कभी कभी हिंसा में जो लोग इंडल्ज हैं पूरी तरह से, मार रहे हैं, लोगों की हत्या कर रहे हैं, वहां पर मानवाधिकार की ह्यूमन राइट्स की बात की जाती है, लेकिन इस देश के को सुरक्षित रखने की जिम्मेदारी जिन लोगों के द्वारा निभाई जा रही है, हमारे सुरक्षा के जवानों की, क्या उनका मानवाधिकार नहीं होता? क्या उनका अपना ह्यूमन राइट नहीं है? लेकिन मैं जानता हूं कि बहुत लोग इसकी पूरी सावधानी बरतते हैं और इस बात का हमको ध्यान रखना भी चाहिए। और मेरा यह भी मानना है कि मीडिया तंत्र सत्ता को आईना दिखाए, लेकिन आईना किसी रंग से पुता हुआ नहीं होना चाहिए। आईने पर जैसे ही रंग कोई पुत जाता है, उसकी विश्वसनीयता निश्चित रूप से संदेह के घेरे में आ जाती है। इसलिए इस संबंध में भी मैं मानता हूं कि हम सबको सावधानी बरतनी चाहिए। मित्रों, समाज में हम सबके अपने विचार हो सकते हैं, अलग अलग विचारधाराएं भी हो सकती हैं। मैं जानता हूं कुछ ऐसे भी मीडिया मैनेजमेंट हैं जिनकी एक अपनी आइडियोलॉजी है, एक अपना थाट है, लेकिन मेरा यह मानना है कि उन्हें न्यूज के साथ मिक्सअप करने की कोशिश नहीं करनी चाहिए। समाचार पत्रों में न्यूज न्यूज की तरह दी जानी चाहिए। समाचार पत्रों में कुछ दूसरे भी स्पेस होते हैं, आप उस स्पेस में अपना विचार अभिव्यक्त कर सकते हैं। यह मेरा मानना है, यह हमारी धारणा है। मेरा निर्धारित समय 15 मिनट का था, लेकिन मैंने शायद उससे ज्यादा समय ले लिया। मैं सचमुच इस कार्यक्रम में आकर अपने को बहुत ही सौभाग्यशाली मान रहा हूं, और इस समाचार पत्र के प्रति जो एक विश्वसनीयता, एक भरोसा गोयनका जी ने कायम रखा है, ये आगे भी चलती रहेगी, इसका मुझे पक्का भरोसा, पक्का और भी विश्वास है। लेकिन इसके साथ मैं यह भी कहना चाहूँगा कि जिन मूल्यों को उन्होंने अपने जीवन में स्वीकारा है अथवा जिन वैल्यूज के प्रति उनका कमिटमेंट रहा है, वो हम कमिटमेंट हम अपने भी जीवन में उतारने की कोशिश करें। यह मेरी आप सभी से यह प्रार्थना है, और जिन लोगों को आज अवार्ड प्राप्त हुआ है उन सबको मैं अपनी तरफ से हार्दिक शुभकामनाएं देता हूं। जिन लोगों को अवार्ड नहीं मिला है, मैं पूरी तरह से आश्वस्त हूं कि वह ऐसा प्रयत्न करेंगे कि भविष्य में उनको भी निश्चित रूप से अवार्ड मिलेगा। इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ आप सबको बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your valuable thoughts. May I now request Mr. Anant Goenka, Executive Director, Indian Express Group, to join us on stage and present a special token to the Honorable Union Minister of Home Affairs, Shri Rajnath Singh. Friends, this portrait is made by C.R. Sasi Kumar, Chief Illustrator, The Indian Express. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you, Anant. I now request Mr. Raj Kamal Jha, Chief Editor, The Indian Express, to come up on stage and propose a formal vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sangeeta, very much. To give the vote of thanks for a newspaper editor in an election year is fraught with risk. You are not sure what will be seen as a vote and what will be seen as a thanks. Because we seem to be voting all the time. We are participants in an opinion poll, 24/7. We are constantly marking out our positions, then we are unmarking them. We applaud or abuse, left or right, yes or no, pliable or viable, black or white. Gray we don't like. Because it is very boring. Gray means I'm old. Gray means I don't know. Gray doesn't get many retweets. In fact, one of the few times we see gray is when our phone is switched off. That's the color of the screen. We stare at it, waiting for it to come on. I'm so happy to know that the Ramnath Goenka Journalism Awards defiantly celebrate the opposite. They reward work that strives to get to the gray. There are no bullet points or PowerPoints. These are stories that need to be told and are told in a very eloquent fashion. So thank you first, the award winners. I think you need a collective round of applause. For each one of you, the story may bring individual honors, it may jazz up your CV, but it sustains us all. And thank you very much, Honorable Home Minister Rajnath Singh Ji, for standing behind this work and giving it your hand. Your definition of journalism, jo aapne patrakarita ki paribhasha ki, it could not be more relevant. Your definition of journalism as fundamental to democracy is something that will keep inspiring every newsroom in the country. Thank you very much, sir. We are very privileged to have you on stage, and just a few feet away from the stage, we are very lucky to have Harivansh Ji, a former editor himself, and now the deputy chairman of the upper house. Mr. Piyush Goyal, we had K.J. Alphonse Ji, we have Mr. Farooq Abdullah Ji, Abhishek Singhvi, D. Raja, Anil Baluni, Derek O'Brien, G.V.L. Rao, Manish Tiwari, Javed Khan, Sudhanshu Trivedi Ji, Manoj Tiwari Ji, Bhupendra Yadav, and Justice A.P. Shah. We have the former INB Minister Tiwari Ji. In times so deeply divided, there couldn't be a better story for journalism than having this Mahagathbandhan. Being here in this room, celebrating good journalism. It may be for one winter evening in this cold city, but it is worth it. So thank you very much for being here today. And Sanjay Singh Ji of AAP, So, you know, it is wonderful to see so many people who disagree on fundamental issues, but who are here today to celebrate what is good journalism. So thank you very much. And in the end, a thought that I would like to share as I set the stage for the next event, which my colleague Seema will lead. There is something that goes unsaid at every evening, that behind each story that has won an RNG award, there are women and men who we will never know. They are the subjects of the stories, of course. They are sources who share information with us. There are editors who tell the reporter to get the story. There are copy editors who check the story for facts. There are designers, there are publishers, and there are owners who take decisions. There are people in marketing and advertising who get resources to get the story told. There are even reporters who are not in this room today, but whose work many of the RNG award-winning stories have built upon. It is the web of these relationships that creates the space for good journalism. And when any of the relationship goes wrong, that space shrinks. We saw a few examples of this last year. One was the Me Too movement, which shone the light on how one relationship was violated in some newsrooms. So we thank those who broke the silence, and thank those for breaking our silence. We have a panel discussion after this with wonderful newsroom leaders to discuss what editors can and should do, because on a day we shine the spotlight on the best, it is very healthy to reflect on what lies in the shadows. There could not be a more journalistic way, a more grayer way, to wish you a very, very happy new year. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Raj Kamal Jha. And now, friends, to make it special, for all the winners of the Ramnath Goenka Excellence in Journalism Awards 2017, may I please request Anant, members of the jury, all our award winners with their trophies, and all the sponsors present here to please join us on stage for a group photograph with the Honorable Union Minister of Home Affairs, Sri Rajnath Singh. May I request everyone to please be seated once again as we continue with our program this evening, which is the Ramnath Goenka Memorial Discussion in just a few minutes. Please be seated so we can get started with that discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, an event of this scale and proportion could not have been achieved without the unstinting support from our partners. I mention their names once again, our presenting partner TVS, associate partners NABARD, Bharat Petroleum, Uttar Pradesh Government, JAL, Pitambari, Government of Assam, NDMC, PC Jeweler, Sonalika, REC, Gateway Rail, Flywell Aviation, NTPC, HPM, MP Government, and SRTMI. The event partner, LIC of India, NGO partner, Save the Children, banking partner, Union Bank of India, and writing instruments partner, Parker. The Ramnath Goenka Memorial Foundation today is proud to once again celebrate excellence in journalism. May I request everyone over here to please be seated so we can go ahead with our panel discussion. So, ladies and gentlemen, our topic today for discussion is hashtag MeToo in the newsroom, what editors can and should do. For this, I'd like to invite our panelists, Ms. Dhanya Rajendran, co-founder and editor-in-chief, The News Minute, Ms. Meenal Baghel, editor, Mumbai Mirror, Ms. Ritu Kapoor, co-founder and chief executive officer, The Quint, Ms. Rupa Jha, head of Indian Languages, BBC World Service, and the moderator for this discussion is Seema Chishti, deputy editor, The Indian Express. Request all the wonderful ladies to come up. And for discussing hashtag MeToo in the newsroom, what editors can and should do, I hand over to Seema Chishti, Deputy Editor, The Indian Express. Over to you, Seema.
Hey, thanks a lot.
Can we have order, please? May I request order, please, so we can listen to the great panelists.
So hello and a very good evening to all of you. At the back of a scintillating award function, I have an equally scintillating and a very eminent panel here to discuss and debate, hopefully, Me Too in India, what newsrooms can and should do. I'm Seema Chishti, and we have with us Dhanya Rajendran, we have Ritu Kapoor, we have Meenal Baghel, and we have Rupa Jha. So from the time that Tanya Burke, about 17 years ago, in a somewhat different context, brought up the phrase Me Too, and then the actor Aliza Milano sort of brought it up more recently, we've had like an avalanche of revelations of people talking about some very deep, dark, and disturbing experiences, sharing them. And perhaps expectedly, the newsroom has been very central to that debate as participants and as reporters, which was perhaps natural because you have some of the most articulate women voices were perhaps to be found in the media that you had this. We had Tanushree Dutta 3 months ago talk about it, and then we had much more which hit a senior editor. A minister was forced to resign, and then there was a court case, there was a lot of victim shaming, the system also kind of got back and did things. We have a lot to discuss here today. Our theme is what newsrooms can and should do. So there is a lot of chatter around where do we go in Me Too from here in 2019. Where do we go by way of just making it about posh committees, about workshops, Is it going to be just that? Or is there deeper, darker questions we need to talk about and talk about the responsibility and the role of all of us, not just as women, but as senior women editors, which is why we thought it would be marvelous to have women editors who take a lot of decisions, all of which are not because they're women, but a lot of them, most of them, being because they're editors. And this is something that's come up now in a way that hasn't really been resolved, and we're far from closure on this. So we will get into a discussion amongst us, and we'll throw it open to the audience a little later. But before that, may I invite each of you to have your say briefly and flag some things that you think should be put on the table. Dhania, would you like to start?
Hi. So when the Me Too movement started, as a woman, as an individual, I felt really happy that there was an outpouring and women were coming forward to speak about those things which were taboo. They were scared to speak about it. They feared that they would be humiliated. As a journalist, initially, yes, the first two or three days we had to report on the trend of Me Too, the fact that people are naming and shaming on Twitter and other social media. But after two or three days, I think the journalistic rigor sort of set in, that if you want to go ahead and report a story, like it was done in America and other countries, that you have to follow all the discipline, a proper journalistic exercise. So from then on, it became like that. Having covered Me Too for the last 1 month, and I believe that it has started conversations about what is workplace harassment, about what covers workplace harassment, what should we do as a workplace, how do we protect our employees, how do we give training to them. I think these conversations were completely missing in the Indian context, and those conversations have started. As far as newsrooms are concerned, I'm sorry to say that most newsrooms in India do not have internal complaints committees. They have not trained their journalists. They do not conduct workshops. So even for newsrooms, it's been a revelation. Me Too has been a revelation. So naming and shaming and the shock from the naming and shaming, I think we are over that now. Now we need to move to the next step of Me Too, which is to ensure that all organizations have ICCs as per law, that employees are told that there are policy changes. So I think now we need to move beyond the naming and shaming, and as journalists, think how we can report on Me Too better so that there are more policy-driven things.
How did this Me Too become a sort of the globally the most powerful hashtag? I think the answer to that, we need to step back from individual stories and understand the difference between public voice and private voice. I mean, there's this, the first recorded instance of a woman being told to shut up in public is to be found in Homer's Odyssey, written 3,000 years ago. Penelope, who is waiting for her husband Ulysses, about whom Odyssey is, to return from the Trojan Wars, and one day she steps out of her private quarters and goes to the palace hall, which is the public sphere, and where she's and which is full of men, and there she hears a bard singing about the troubled journeys of the returning Greek heroes, and she says to the bard that, why don't you sing something more joyful, something more hopeful? At this point, her son, who is barely a teenager, steps up and shuts her up and says, Mother, go back to your private quarters and go about your womanly business. Speech is the business of men, all men. So the idea of, you know, the historian Mary Beard, who recounts this, says that at the very start of chronicling of Western civilization as we know it, it's very, very clear that women can speak in private domain, but not in the public domain. Fast forward to the 21st century, what happened is that social media, for the first time, gave women access to a public platform so that they could speak publicly. And which is why, when Priya Ramani sort of outed MJ Akbar, or Ghazala Wahab, who wrote sort of very movingly about her experience, what does Mr. Akbar do? He actually does what Penelope's son did 3,000 years ago, which is he tries to shut up the women. Well, how? By saying, I will file defamation, by saying these are lies. And what happened to many women who had worked with him is that, aside from the experience that they might have had with him, this shutting up all over again and to stop them from speaking in public is what really kind of enraged many of us. And I remember when I was writing that petition, there were women who were spread over continents, across time zones. We had not met with each other in 20 years, but they all started sort of signing up and saying, please add my name, please add my name. I remember, and the Express journalist to whom I had passed on the petition, and I'm very glad that Express gave it the due consideration that they did. But the fact is that even as he was putting out the story, I was adding more names. And you know, at the end of it all, it felt like those of you who have seen Mirch Masala, you know, the women who run up to the character of Nasiruddin Shah, sort of angrily flinging those chilies. And there's just a lot of rage. And I think what's the thing about Me Too is that women are now saying that they will no longer be kept out of public debate. And so the rest of the world has to just deal with it.
Yeah, I know that by invoking Telemachus, you said something sort of very basic. Ritu, your 2 minutes.
I think the naming and shaming and the anger and the speaking out was, I think it was kept silent for so many decades that, and you know, I'm sure almost every woman who's here, including myself, we've all been subjected to sexual harassment somewhere or the other. And in my generation, you sort of reported and you quit because there was no way of staying on after you had called somebody out. But at least, you know, you did call people out. The important thing, I think, is a given that the naming and shaming and the outrage on social media was much needed. But I think now, if you were to say, how do you make this movement meaningful? What do we as editors or people who are running newsrooms, what do we do now? And you know, some of the answers are obvious. I mean, obviously you have to have a very representative IC where, you know, it's not just, you know, senior people sitting in the IC that it's representative. It has to have, it should be a reflection or representative of the demographic across the newsroom. But I think one of the things that comes to me immediately is that we need more women in newsrooms in all organizations. I think it has to be consciously a 50-50 representation, gender representation in newsrooms, because that's the only way. And I don't mean just hiring women. I mean in terms of the voice of women journalists in prime time debates. How many women are representing the debate? You know, that the voice of the women has to be there, because otherwise it's just becomes a movement that happened on the side and there were angry women. It has to go beyond that. And the other thing that I think it's important for this movement to make a radical change is it has to become meaningful to officially or formally report. Because if it's only going to be women speaking out on social media anonymously or otherwise, then it's not really going to sustain. But the thing is that if a woman has to go file an FIR or take legal recourse, or to even in some instances, in slightly hostile management situations, even, you know, initiate an IC proceeding, it's tough. We know from the Tehelka case that there is an example there where, you know that if I'm going to report, the legal process or the due process is going to string me out. So I think it's important for the Me Too movement to also allow us as a country to relook at some of the laws to somehow fast track, because a lot of these cases are he said, she said, a lot of them are anonymous. It's very confounding. It's not easy. The other thing that we need, I think, is apart from having a far stronger representation of women in newsrooms, is one of the things that I think that has happened is, and it's good in a lot of ways, it's men are scared. And I think there's a lot of good that comes out of scared men, because I think there's been years of men not being scared and men knowing what they can do. But I think there's I now find that men are not part of the conversation on Me Too or on sexual harassment. They're quiet. And I think for this movement to be meaningful, it'll have to be introspection and men have to be part of the conversation. I can tell you that very often in our debate, in even our newsrooms, when it comes to this, men fall silent. They're too wary of saying something which may be hurtful or which may come across as inappropriate. So I think what Dhania said about sensitization, workshops, awareness sessions, etc., are really, really important. And I think one of the things that's not been happening is proper documentation by HR. You know, I think there have been too many instances of men being quietly sacked or let off because they are sexual predators, but they can go and be hired in other newsrooms. There isn't enough of a paper trail or a documentation trail for future organizations to look at and to assess whether they want that individual or not. So I mean, we can talk about it a little bit.
Thank you for a detailed look at what could be done. Rupa, you're concerned about how all this connects to the larger world, and you see it as something beyond the newsroom.
Absolutely. First of all, thank you very much for having me here, and the panel looks fantastic because it's very unusual to have all women here. It's not only about Me Too impact. I know more women are coming out and speaking their mind. You mentioned about Me Too, the hashtag, and it became a world trend. Before that, only 33% of Americans felt that sexual harassment at workplace was an issue. And after that, 15th October 2017, 88% felt that this is a serious issue. So that's what the contribution of Me Too is. It's been a moment of solidarity for all of us, for men, for women. And it also has shown us, reflected the potential of feminist politics to transform social space, which is not an isolated or individual extension. And that is what the beauty of Me Too is for me. I know what newsrooms can do and should do. Before that, a lot of things have to be done and changed outside newsroom. Having said that, I am a team leader, fairly new in the role for the past 2 years, and I feel that social change is not inevitable. It is negotiated. And we, as editors in newsrooms, as journalists, we can negotiate. We can be the starting point of the change, which we have. And we are engaging with all of it in a very constructive way. And you know that of course it's not easy and it's going to be difficult. It needs a lot of courage, a lot of political will. But many times editors do not realize the power that they have to change and set the rules. And as Dushyant Kumar very rightly said, that kaun kehta hai ki aasman mein surakh ho nahi sakta, ek patthar to tabiyat se uchhalo yaro. So wo moment hai. Mauka bhi hai, dastoor bhi hai, that we all can make that change. Very quickly, I know 2 minutes and I'll be cut off. I think if you ask me that as a news editor, how will I like to see the changes in my newsroom, I'll go back to what Ritu was saying and what Dhania also mentioned, that it has to be a diversified newsroom. What newsrooms are missing out, besides news, of course, now no offense meant to any media houses, is a diversified newsroom in a genuine way. We don't have. We don't even look at how our newsrooms are constructed and we function. The only report that I could find out was way back in 2006, which was done by Anil Chamaria and Yogendra Yadav. And, you know, they just did 300 journalists based out of Delhi, very small sample size, but you'll understand what I'm trying to make a point, that out of that, 71% was held by upper caste Hindu men. So we don't have a diversified newsroom. If we start doing that, if we look at our recruitment policy, are we reaching out to a diverse talent pool? If we fight out our unconscious bias towards what women can do, what they can't do, and of course, believe in sisterhood. That's what Me Too again demonstrated, that you know there has to be a sustained, continued struggle and commitment that you know we can make the newsrooms more inclusive and equitable for each one of us.
Thank you, Rupa. Thank you all. Just to get our discussion sort of going, how have Indian newsrooms generally done with reporting Me Too? So you have Mr. Fanon at The New Yorker, Harvey Weinstein breaks out, and as you said, it is a he says, she says moment. He goes out and there's a 10-month investigation. He speaks to 13 women in detail. documents things, and there is a story. There is something there which is tangible, which respects testimonies, but just doesn't leave it at that, but goes and investigates. Why haven't we had that here in India? Not just reporting what's kind of broken somewhere in some social media space, which is very useful, but gone beyond that and done the hard yards. Why has that not happened? Thoughts?
You know, I can tell you from the experience of our newsroom. Now, our newsroom comprises at least 50-55% is a lot of young women journalists. And I'll be honest enough to say that I think for a lot of our young, I think Me Too triggered a lot of personal experiences. I think we, because of that, because of our, you know, you've got to respect that sentiment in the newsroom, I think there was a little more activism than pure journalism when it came to reporting Me Too. I mean, one did the, while we did the thing of, you know, right of reply, you reached out to the accused or the person who'd been named or shamed. But in terms of deeper investigation, I think it took a while for us to be able to move towards that. I can tell you that we had conversations like, should we do a story on presumption of guilt? And there was a very strong view in our newsroom against doing something like that, because there was a fear that it's a movement that's just beginning to gather strength. It needs that kind of activist backing for a while. But and so it took a while. I think because it's a movement, you know, as they say, you know, the soul of a people long suffering finding utterance after such a long time, that I think it went off key. But I think the important thing is that it's now beginning to, the only thing that it's important is I think we have to not stop reporting. I think one of the problems is that when there's a surge, all media chases it, it's reported, and then it dies down and the next new shiny thing happens. In our instance, it's elections now. So elections shouldn't prevent us from continuing to report meaningfully on Me Too.
I think there's a larger question to how we look at such issues, you know. We, as media houses, we never paid attention. We didn't give it as much importance as one should to, you know, to start off with. We were just kind of trying to understand, acha, ye victim shaming hai, ya ye karna chahiye, nahi karna chahiye. You know, there was a lot of confusion about A, how to report it, and B, should this be reported or not? And that's an honest assessment. Some of the media houses, of course, went out and were very brave. But most of the media houses, I thought, you know, they took time to even take the cognizance of the issue and the seriousness of the issue to report about. What do you think?
I think there are some very sort of, the key issue is that increasingly people's mistrust of mainstream media, which is why a lot of women chose to speak out on Twitter rather than approach journalists, which is something we need to look at. Second is, I think as a newspaper, I'll tell you that we took a call that we will not report any anonymous allegations. So that, I mean, I strongly feel that women have to take ownership of their allegations. So I think that deterred a lot of people from stepping forward. And I think that the third reason is that even though a lot of women did kind of mention some names and shame people on Twitter, when it came to speaking at length and to kind of holding on to their narratives, a lot of the women did back out. So it was not so easy. I think what Ronan Farrow did was incredible. Also, the kind of time that American news magazines allowed, we just don't have the luxury of that time.
Tanya, you're a new media thing. How, did you kind of go down the road and do some reporting, your units?
So first, I just want to say that I think we shouldn't confuse Me Too with the police process where we're looking for evidence and it shouldn't be a he said and a me said and she said. Because the movement is to encourage women to speak out what they would otherwise not have spoken out loud. Like, we all have our internal systems where we tell, there's a whisper campaign, right, amongst women. There's a man who molests, or just be careful about it. It's a whisper system which sort of became public, like Meenal said in the beginning. So I think we shouldn't confuse Me Too with the policing system as to, is there enough proof? But as a journalist,
reporting, yeah.
While reporting, yes, we have to ask for corroborations, we have to ask for proof, but in many cases, there were none. In many cases, the women were too shocked at that time, shocked for many years, in fact, and obviously there's no proof of what happened. But as journalists, then what can we look for? Is there anyone who can corroborate it? So I think most media houses did follow some of these things. There were some really good stories. I think the BCCL story by News Laundry, there were a couple of really good in-depth stories. Should we do more? Of course, I know of a lot of media houses who are trying to investigate big names, but it's not easy. And I actually disagree with Meenal when she says that women have to own up to the allegations they make and they cannot be anonymous. The whole point of the movement is that there are many women who still cannot afford to put their name, their face on the allegation. As a journalist, if I know the person, they can still remain anonymous for my audience. Right? But
at some point they have to step up, because if you're sued for defamation, then I think it's important for them to step up at some point.
That's definitely there. I mean, as a media organization, you're going to get sued. But my point is, as a journalist, can we insist that all these women come out and put their names and faces there? I don't think so. Why did the Raya Sarkar list come up? Because there are so many people who are suffering within the system. They want to remain anonymous, and they know that the due process is flawed. They're not going, and many of them, mind it, are not even looking for justice. This whole journalistic notion of justice is not what Me Too is also about. They just want to tell the world that this is what happened to me. They're not looking for justice. Yeah, a lot of them are not looking for justice.
But where do we put the due process then? You know, the question of...
What is due process?
What exactly. So what is due process? And there is, I mean, there's rule of law. There is spirit of natural justice. I mean, these are the,
But that has not helped all these women for so many years.
True. No, but also, does that really help us? I mean, does that really give us, what do you say that in English? Right. To report on things which may not be true. I mean, that's the conundrum I'm talking about.
As a journalist, definitely not. As an organization, you shouldn't report it. I'm not saying no. But I think there are some rules that need to be broken while covering this. We cannot go by the old rule book anymore.
But, you know, there's a difference, Dhanya, between being a social media platform where you can put out things and rules of journalism don't apply there. And there's a difference between being a journalistic platform. A journalistic platform can't start mirroring social media, because I think then there's
so
a lot of...
So everything about MG Akbar was also he said, she said. Why did we report on it?
Because a lot of women came forward. Women took ownership of what they were saying.
So these women are in privileged positions. They could take ownership. There are so many women who cannot. So do we not help them at all?
No, you're right.
I'll frame a question coming from here. You mentioned the Raya Sarkar list. I'm sure everybody's aware of that. But that Excel spreadsheet where there were a lot of anonymous people and a lot of names from academia were mentioned. How does one report a list like that? Because there is enormous power in somebody getting up in the Me Too times and getting up and saying something, which is probably true, but which may also be not true sometimes. So where does one... how does one deal with that power that somebody now has about naming somebody? And as you said,
I think the old playbook may have broken, but
do we need a new playbook?
I think the problem with the Raya Sarkar list, and also my personal problem with anonymous allegations, is that how does the other person respond? Like, if you are naming 10 people and calling them sexual predators, do we not hear their side of the story? How can Me Too go forward if you do not give men also a platform to respond to the allegations that are being made to them?
I think, yeah, I mean, reporting whatever is happening, but also giving right to reply to the person who is being accused in that list will be a fair way of doing our journalism, isn't it?
You don't think so, Dhanya?
No, I agree with all this, but I mean, the Raya Sarkar list, before we came here, we were discussing about the Raya Sarkar list, should we have reported about the list or not? I think I would like to take Scroll's name. They did a wonderful job of actually putting out the fact that they did not name the people on that list, but the fact to look at the list as something which is out of frustration that the system is not working. I mean, we have to understand the feminist movement is also evolving. It's using technology now. That's what the Raya Sarkar list was all about. So to report it and highlight to the world that the list had to come out simply because there is no way these women were getting any relief from the institutions they were part of. Many of them were research scholars. They could not get their PhDs if they spoke against their guides or professors, etc. So that list really opened the floodgates, I would say. should we have reported on individual cases? Then, yes, all journalistic rigor had to be followed, right to reply, why are organizations not acting on it? But I think the Raya Sarkar list in itself, everyone should have reported on it because it was a new movement.
Okay. Just coming back into the newsroom, and we all work in space with the men and women working together, open plan offices mostly and all that, plenty of interaction. Is there a sense that there is some kind of a age divide, as you very rightly said, Dhanya, that you know feminism is like a work in progress and evolving and all that. Is there something about being 45 and above where women feminists
who is
or otherwise
45?
Complete pakka feminists, but they respond differently to things that people not that wonderful age do? And how do we deal with that? And what do some of us who are on the other side feel about it?
I think there's a very, very clear, Me Too actually has been entirely, the credit goes to a younger generation of women. They have shown the kind of anger and the inability to take, if I may say, use the word bullshit, which I think the older women would sort of just look the other way. And I think the younger women are really bringing about a change in not just newsrooms, but I think they're creating a new office space because they are, the things that they take offense to, they are much more aware of their rights, they are much more politically correct, and they know it's also a challenge to authority. They're not afraid to challenge authority, which say people 15 years, 20 years ago were.
But it is also, Seema, I think of course they are not afraid of the authority, and this is all, you know, to the younger generation, but there is a language divide. You know, it is so much led by urban English-speaking journalists that we have not even looked to the regional media houses, the newsrooms where, you know, of Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, Punjabi, Gujarati, all that what I am dealing with. So I think, of course, it's a great start, and we hope that this will just kind of trickle down to all those newsrooms, definitely.
So about the age gap, I would safely assume I'm the youngest here.
Totally correct.
But even in my newsroom where I have 21, 22, 23, 24-year-olds, I'll tell you a small example where there is this 60-plus-year-old man who I've known for many years. I introduce him to a young reporter in my team for something. And he sends her a message. It was not lewd, but it was just... she did not appreciate the message.
What now, did he say?
He said, pretty. Okay, so, but she said, I take offense to it. I don't know him. He's 60-plus. Why should he say that to me? And what Me Too really taught me is to start looking at things from another person's perspective. That I may not find it problematic, but she does. And that's her viewpoint, and I have to respect it. Something which I thought was not lewd, or I brushed it off as not workplace harassment, that standard may not apply to someone else in my organization. Everyone's sensitivities are different. I think the one big thing I learned from covering Me Too and also speaking about in the newsroom is that all of us do not see it. What constitutes as harassment for one person, it does not for the other.
Prithu, what do you think about a lot of women who think it's very hail fellow well met and it's chalta, it's okay because there's a collegial
atmosphere. I think the big difference is I think our generation, because some of it was normalized, a lot of the lewd jokes, we were actually part of it. I think our generation, I can tell you that when I started working, there was no private television. There was only Doordarshan, and the only way that I could get the camera people or the other crew to take me seriously is to crack the same kind of jokes as them. So I think our entry level dealing with the whole gender issue conditioned us and made us normalize a lot of things. I think what's great about the Me Too movement is that the younger generation has decided that they're going to want to take it up on an institutional level. We dealt with it on a one-on-one. I'll deal with the guy on my, I won't take the bullshit, but I'll give it back to him, but on a one-on-one basis. I think the point that Rupa is making is an important one, which is that this whole thing, this whole debate, this whole conversation that we're having is still a very tiny Twitterverse environment. I've spoken to some of the, you know, my colleagues that I know who are in Hindi newsrooms or regional newsrooms, and I had that conversation because I know what they've dealt with, and it hasn't yet percolated down because they're very clearly saying that, you know, if I was to speak out, I'm actually going to be isolated. I'm not even going to get support. So I think one of the things, One of the things that's come out of the normalizing of our generation, which I think is important for the younger, is that we were, a lot of us were aware of a lot of what was going on, but we didn't get together and speak about it. A lot of us knew about a lot of people who have now been called out and named and shamed, but I think that is important. It's important for newsrooms and organizations to now be sensitized, which is if the one individual, like I'm talking about this one former colleague in a Hindi newsroom who's not going to speak out because the Hindi media newsroom hasn't really evolved till there, is can other people speak out? Now that's one of the issues.
No, I think that's the power.
That's one of the things, you know, that happened, yeah, with Me Too. No, right? Other women spoke out for women, absolutely, who was hesitant.
And why
is that okay?
No, why did it happen when, 10 years back, that we did, I mean, these things were there much before the hashtag became popular. I think there was no sense of sisterhood. I mean, you know, like, that you would find support, like, one Priya Ramani comes out and 10 more women come out. It does make a lot of difference. And when it's happening all across the globe at the same time, it gives you a lot of courage.
So I follow 4 regional languages closely, Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, and Kannada. There have been 2 big cases in Kannada and Tamil, which is singer Chinmayi spoke against Vairamuthu and actor Shruti spoke against Arjun. Now, there are 2 things which are happening in regional newsrooms. One, the conversation of Me Too has not reached there in the workplace, which is most of these regional news channels, papers do not have ICCs and they don't care even now. Many of them have not formed it. 2, there is no conversations in their newsrooms about it, which also reflects in the way they cover it. For example, Chinmayi, except I think 1 or 2 Tamil, or maybe 4 or 5 Tamil organizations, almost everyone has been busy shaming her. The same goes for Shruti. So I think the coverage, the sensitization has to begin from the newsroom. We are so patriarchal, we have so many misogynists amongst us, we have no sympathy, no empathy while covering this, and we are expecting the world to have it. Let's start from our newsrooms.
So you mentioned about sort of the bias, which is the caste bias as well, that comes in and that skews things. Can Me Too kind of be divorced from the politics of the day? Can it be divorced from other identities, from, you know, as we said, that there is this complete, perhaps an over-reporting, as it were, if I may use that phrase, of people of a certain entitlement, as it were, and not in other places. So what can we do in our roles as journalists to go out and extend the sisterhood or that rigor or that fellowship and report on other things? Is there something, has it been divorced from politics? Is that the problem, that it's just, you know, we've just kind of outsourced it to other people to kind of do it?
No,
without
I absolutely
politics.
Feel that, you know, like Me Too is not in isolation. It's part of whatever is constructing our country and the social structure that we are living in, whether it's caste, it's gender, everything is connected, whether it's politics. When MJ Akbar happened and that the government didn't react, of course it gave the kind of message. And that is the kind of, that's a message that you send out to various people out there, that it's okay not to respond and it could be one frivolous thing. So everything is connected. When we talk of a diversified newsroom, that's exactly what I mean, that it cannot be just a gender-specific diversity. It has to be caste, it has to be, you know, a different gender, not only man and woman, but, you know, third gender and LGBTQ. So there's a lot that is connected and politics definitely part of it. Unless we deal with that, I don't think we are going to have the real impact of Me Too movement the moment that it has given to us.
Meena, what do you think? No, will that dilute Me Too?
No, I actually totally agree with Rupa. And I think we are moving towards, at least in certain sections, we are moving towards, greater representation of all genders, where, you know, people are aware now, more aware of when they're hiring. I think most newsrooms, at least in English media, a lot of us are trying to be inclusive and so I think, like, for instance, the ratio of women has gone up in a lot of the English media newsrooms. I can't speak for the language newsrooms where I think
no,
it's still
skewed.
No, but
looking at this, it seems 100% has changed.
No. Actually, there are not that many women.
No, but it's not only about getting good soldiers. It's about having diversified people as decision makers. It's not only about getting foot soldiers, right?
I can tell you, I was last year I was at a conference, a journalism conference, where on day one of the conference, I was the only woman at a journalism conference. And I was having a debate with a senior editor from a mainstream, big English newspaper.
Description.
Yeah.
Which
and said, I was astounded that even today the conversation went to, and I was saying that, you know, we've got to correct this. You can't have a journalism conference where there is one woman currently, and the same old conversation came up again. No, we have a lot of women in our newsroom. They're all in the features section. You know, I mean, you can't say that. Again, there was a lot of the presumed thing, but you know, they don't like to do the night shift. You know, the thing is that they want to keep it flexible because they have kids at home. You know, there's in the guise of, I think there's a lot of other things beyond just, that's what I'm saying, that beyond just having, hiring enough women or having enough diversity, it's about, so the question is often, it's not safe for a woman to go report from that area. Or it's not safe for a woman. So, you know, the thing is, what do you do to make it safe? So you have to take the onus as an organization, as a senior editor, to let women be in mainstream reporting roles and to make sure that you're providing for them, for them to be safe. So that this conversation of, yes, we do have reporters, but they prefer to be in the feature section. Who decided that?
And also, I think create newsrooms where women who are young mothers can still contribute significantly. So you have to change the newsroom culture. You know, you can have 5-day weeks. You can have flexible hours. But I think it's important that this conversation has started it.
I think many of the women journalists who are here, each one of us can have a story to share right now, that why certain role, certain story, certain beat was given or not given to them based on their gender and not on their capability as a journalist. And we have to also relook at the way we look at so-called soft and hard journalism.
But this is in the government too. It's across
everywhere. I mean, see, that's what I'm saying, that nothing is devoid. I mean, everything is connected. We are all part of the system, and unless everything, it's the overhauling of the entire system, only Me Too in newsroom and dealing with that will not make any difference. Yeah. I think it has to be an overall.
You're absolutely right, Rupa, but I want to just drive down to that fundamental question we started with before we open the floor for our audience. So if you could quickly kind of tell me the one process that you think, or the thing that you may want to introduce in your newsrooms to make it a more equitable, fair, and a just place. Then you want to go first.
Hiring. To have an inclusive newsroom. I really try, but sometimes it just doesn't work out, but I wish I could do more of it.
Yeah, I mean, it starts at hiring, but it moves on to making sure that there are equal roles and, you know, equal participation in all things in the newsroom. And for there to be constant training and sensitization, there is a lot of conditioning that the men in the newsroom have come with.
Even the women.
Even the women. So I think that conditioning is not going to go away tomorrow, and I don't think fear and threat is going to be the solution. I think you've got to have a constant sensitization thing, and like I said, and the kind of content that the newsroom looks at, you know, including reporting on Me Too. I think one of the things that we have to do is a lot of the reporting on Me Too dwells on the details of how the sexual harassment took place. I think pushing some of that out of the way, it's how you're reporting constantly. Everything that you're reporting has to be sensitive to gender issues.
Meena?
I think hiring, and second, very clearly giving out a message that when somebody does come to you with an issue related to sexual harassment, to sort of, the first instinct should not be to disbelieve them or to dismiss their story, but to actually set a due process in place. Very, very important to give out this message to colleagues in the newsroom.
Yeah, absolutely. Picking up from what Meenal said, that stop, pause, and listen when somebody says it has been hard journey, man or woman. Of course, hiring, as I said earlier in my opening remark, recruitment policy, unconscious bias. I feel very strongly about it and believe in the strength of collective.
Can I just add, definitely more women in senior roles. I think every newsroom across needs to have women in senior roles, because all said and done, a woman's boss will be more sensitive to situations.
Okay, on that rather interesting note, let's open the floor for any of you who might have things to say or contribute. Please identify yourselves and wait for one of my colleagues to reach you with a microphone. If you'd like to raise your hand if you have something to say. Can we get a microphone here, please?
My name is Gopal Pillai, but I think if you really want this, and this is from experience which I've noticed right across companies and in the government, you'll find that 90 or 92% statistics would show that people who complained, women who complained, have lost their jobs. So it's very important, and I think your HR policy in the newsroom, and this is something which we've done in some of the companies on which I'm in the board of director, we've actually changed our HR policy to say that if a woman complains and it's established, on no account, for whatever reason, she will not be allowed to leave the company. And it's the HR director will be held responsible if she subsequently resigns. Because we've had a case where somebody has been found guilty, dismissed. And the four women who gave the complaint within 30 days, and you can know why it happens, because the rest of the organization says that, look, you're the one who complained, got rid of our boss, etc. And there's so much social pressure that they've all finally resigned and left. So if you can make an HR policy which says that somebody complains and it is held correct, that woman will not be allowed to resign, etc., whatever it is, and it's sort of made mandatory. You will find a big change in the complaints correct. That are coming.
Can we have someone? Yes. We have time for about 5 questions, Rob.
May I?
Please.
Thank you, and I compliment the panelists. I would have been happier that at least by exception, one male member should have also been included.
You're speaking now.
Yeah. So it would have been great had you done it. And I would like to share certain parts of the. It is said that the men will be scared now because of a whole lot of things. We are scared. The laws are so draconic now that if I look at a woman for 10 minutes or 2 minutes, I can be jailed. The dowry laws. Unbelievable kind of suffering which is happening. So there are a whole lot of things which are happening and the pendulum is swinging to the other side. The point is that our generation when we were brought up 30 years ago, 40 years ago, we were looking at Shammi Kapoor's film and a whole lot of media which was telling us to chase women. We were telling us to misbehave. Now we are going back in time and correcting that cultural ethos. So these are some of the very serious problems that somebody who complains of a misbehavior which was 20 years old, how seriously we are going to take it. And then the most important thing is that the relationship, I can tell you the scare. I'm scared of my mother, I'm scared of my wife, I'm scared of my daughter. So the male members are also very much scared of women. So please take it in the right spirit. Thank you.
You know, I think that's a very sad place to be in because we don't want men to be scared. We don't want to lose out on that shared space that we have as, you know, especially as journalists.
Can I just come in on, you know, this is, I want to make the point. Very often this misuse of law, dowry law, rape law, but I'm just saying if you look at the data, the rate of conviction is so, versus the number of cases filed, is so that the opportunity to misuse or the instances of misuse are actually very,
very
small.
Very
relative
and nobody goes to jail for staring at 10 minutes. So
it's
I mean, I'm just saying that there's so much of exaggeration of what men go through if they are accused of something. What have we been seeing in the last 2 months? How many men really are bearing the consequences of the accusations on them? So I think we are forever exaggerating what men will, how men will suffer, and not talking about why women have not been talking for so long. So I think the pendulum has been on one side stuck for too long. It has to slowly start swaying.
Okay, can I? Yes. I'm Rashmi Singh and I'm secretary with the New Delhi Municipal Council. And, you know, one comment and a question both, that how intensely are we looking at the sexual harassment, prevention of sexual harassment, the act, you know, at workplace? Because not much is being heard about that. And incidentally, I was a part of the Ministry of Women and Child when this act was formulated. And I still feel that, you know, being in the various organizations, be it government or the corporate, that the act is still not understood in terms of letter and spirit. It's not the violation per se, but you know, many of the things which provide for enabling environment for the women to feel safe at workplace, you know, as the employer's responsibility, including what Mr. Pillai sir just said, that you know, the transfer part. So you can't, the act actually provides that if a woman has filed a complaint, yeah, and during the course of the inquiry, a woman will not be transferred. But I think we need to add this in our discourse and talk more about it so that it gets ingrained as a part of our working culture. Thank you.
You're absolutely right. I think it's very, very crucial for all organizations to, first of all, put this in place, put systems in place. There are very few, I mean, we've seen in the last 4 or 5 years that more and more institutions are putting recourse mechanisms in place. But that's just not enough. I think everybody working there has to be made aware that there are these recourses in place. It has to be simple. If I have to file a complaint and there has to be a redressal mechanism, it has to be simple and it has to be quick, because justice delayed is really justice denied. And you cannot make it, and I think it works both ways. Resolution works for the man as well as for the woman. So it's very, very important that everybody be made aware, it's simple, and any redressal mechanism has to be quick.
I also think it's important for us to look at the POSH guidelines in the context of Me Too, because Me Too has actually confounded us on how to deal with POSH, you know, as it currently exists. Because now, for instance, Me Too, a lot of the complaints that are coming in are not workplace or your workplace complaints. So where does the organization or where does the IC draw the line? The instances could have been of 10 years ago, 12 years ago, 15 years ago, 4 years ago. They may not have happened at your workplace, but what they are indicating is that that individual could be a sexual deviant or could be a sexual predator. Do you take that issue up? There is sexual harassment. There's online sexual harassment, which is not being, where my journalist is not being harassed by somebody within the newsroom, but it's somebody outside the newsroom. The sexual harassment could take place while she is reporting in the field. Now, am I only, should the IC only now still be, you know, looking only at sexual harassment by one employee, from one employee to the other? Or should we be re-looking at how we are looking at the POSH guidelines? Is it time for us to do another review of the POSH guidelines as well, after, in the context of Me Too?
Yes, please. Last two questions, if there are any. No, I think the panel has succeeded in silencing pretty much everyone.
Most of them are men.
Yeah. So shall we draw a line under the discussion, ladies?
Sure.
Okay, thank you very much for being so patient and participating and sharing your thoughts. Thank you very much, Danya, Ritu, Meenal, and Rupa. Thank you very much. We're very grateful to you. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much, all the distinguished panelists. Dhanya Rajendran, Meenal Baghel, Ritu Kapoor, Ms. Rupa Jha, and Seema Chishti. Thank you for that animated discussion. Thank you, everyone, all the panelists and our guests. Now I request everyone to please join us for high tea. Thank you, and have a great evening.